in Bethlehem. Preparation means to get ready. Help us to be ready to welcome you, O God. As is written in the book of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked road shall become straight, the rough way smooth, and all mankind will see God's salvation. Luke 3, verses 4 through 6.
Thank you, girls. Let's open our worship time this morning with a word of prayer. Would you bow with me? Lord Jesus, you've told us that wherever we gather in your name, you're there. And we take this moment to say thank you that you never leave us alone. Thank you for these people who have come to gather in your name because you have a word that speaks into our hearts and into our lives. Oh God, would you open our hearts and everything about our lives to your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. In your bulletin, would you join me as we confess our sin? Eternal God, in whom we live and move and have our being, whose face is hidden from us by our sins, and whose mercy we forget in the blindness of our hearts. Cleanse us from all our offenses and deliver us from proud thoughts and vain desires, that with reverent and humble hearts we may draw near to you, confessing our faults, confiding in your grace, and finding in you our refuge and strength. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, together. Amen. In the confession of our faith, the words of the Apostles' Creed are printed in your bulletin. Let's join together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Our first reading today is from the book of Exodus, Chapter 12, verses 17 through 20. It's on page 58 in your pew Bible. You shall also observe, you shall also observe the Feast of Unleavened Bread, for on this very day I brought your hosts out of the land of Egypt. Therefore, you shall observe this day throughout your generations as a permanent ordinance. In the first month, on the 14th day of the month, at evening, you shall eat unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at evening. 7 days there shall be no leaven found in your houses. For whoever eats what is leavened, that person shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel, whether he is an alien or a native of the land. You shall not eat anything leavened in all your dwellings. You shall eat unleavened bread. The New Testament reading is from 2 Peter, the third chapter, verses 14 through 18. It's on page 1038 in your pew Bible. Therefore, beloved, since you look for these things, Be diligent to be found by him in peace, spotless and blameless, and regard the patience of our Lord to be salvation. Just as also our beloved brother Paul, according to the wisdom given to him, wrote to you, as also in all his letters, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to understand, which the untaught and unstable distort, as they also do the rest of the scriptures to their own destruction. You, therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, be on your guard, lest being carried away by the error of unprincipled men, you fall from your own steadfastness. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory, both now and to the day of eternity. Amen. Our gospel is from the book of Luke this morning. Please rise if you're able, out of respect for the words and ministry of Christ. On page 872 in your pew Bible, Luke 2, 15 through 21. And it came about when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds began saying to one another, "Let us go straight to Bethlehem then and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they came in haste and found their way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay in the manger. And when they had seen this, they made known the statement which had been told them about this child. And all who heard it wondered at the things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds went back, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, just as had been told them. And when 8 days were completed before his circumcision, his name was then called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb. Here ends the readings.
Last Sunday, we began to look at a connection between the prophetic picture that God gives in His Word, which was given to us through the Exodus event, way back as the Israelites were led out of Egypt. So if you want more detail than what I'm going to give you in about a 30-second review of that, you'll have to go back to the video link that was sent to you on last week's message. But there was that connection between that picture of the Exodus and the message that the angels gave to the shepherds just outside of Bethlehem on that night that Jesus was born. And remember, they told the shepherds that they were going to see a sign. God would give them a sign, and the sign was that they would find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. And to get why that's a sign, you need to go back, I guess, and review that lesson last week. But as we looked at Israel's deliverance last week from Egypt as a picture of Israel being born, as God brought them into their land as a people, after a long period of labor and pain and increasing pressure, they were delivered through the waters of the Red Sea, as we talked about. And then as they were going, remember, God told them, I want you to carry, and we just heard some of the Old Testament background to it, I want you to carry this unleavened bread. And remember, the instruction God had given them was to wrap that unleavened bread in the garments, in the cloaks that they were wearing, and carry it out of Egypt. As we move on then this morning, I want you to keep in mind, as we said last week, that the sign given to the shepherds, baby wrapped in swaddling cloths, that's the sign, was a sign pointing to the identity of this one who was born that night outside of Bethlehem. The one who was born without sin, which means he was unleavened. Remember the meaning of leaven. Jesus was born without sin, just like that unleavened bread that was coming out of Egypt. The one who was born in a village that was called Bethlehem, and you know the meaning of the name Bethlehem, it means house of bread. That's the literal meaning of what Bethlehem is. And then the one who would 30 years later say of himself, I'm the bread of life. So there's connection here going way back to that Old Testament event. But today we want to take a little deeper look into what God was saying when he told the Hebrew people to wrap that unleavened bread in their cloaks as they were coming out of Egypt. And how that event then speaks to the birth of Jesus and even to what we're participating in this morning, this service of Holy Communion. There's a connection, and I think you're going to see it. 33 years after the angel spoke these words to the shepherds, the Bible says it was on the night in which Jesus was betrayed. Jesus and his disciples were together, as the Bible says, for that Passover meal, remembering that Exodus event out of Egypt, remembering what had happened all those 1,500 years earlier. And they were going through their traditional way of remembering the Passover. The unleavened bread was wrapped in a cloth and hidden somewhere in the house, in the room, as is their custom every Passover. They didn't understand, they still don't, as we talked about last week, who that unleavened bread is supposed to represent. It's hidden from them, only God gives understanding of that. And in fact, the idea, even today, that Jesus is the bread of life is hidden from the majority of people in this world, isn't it? Only God gives that understanding. So on the night in which he was betrayed, the Bible says Jesus took that, and this is a symbolic gesture that he made before them. He took that hidden unleavened bread that was wrapped in cloths, and the Bible says he broke it then in front of them, and he gave it to his disciples with these words, I want you to take this and eat it. This is my body, and it's given for you. You see, he gave them understanding that night of what the Passover event 1,500 years earlier was pointing to, and what their wilderness experience for 40 years as they came out of Egypt was also pointing to. In John 6, the Gospel of John, verse 32, in John 6, Jesus says, truly I say to you, it wasn't Moses who gave you bread from heaven, but it was my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. And then Hebrews 4:15 says that Jesus had no sin in him. We know that, right? He was unleavened, but it also tells us he was wrapped in cloths when he came into the world, and he was hidden from the world, announced to shepherds who nobody paid much attention to, in a little town that nobody cared. It wasn't in the big hubbub of Jerusalem or some other big city, hidden from the world, announced to lowly shepherds. That's how he came into the world. And did you know, by the way, that's also how he left this world? Same picture. John 19:40 tells us that when they took the body of Jesus down from the cross, they wrapped it in cloths. They bound it in linen cloths with spices, as was their burial custom. Now, 3 days later, Peter and John had been told by Mary Magdalene that Jesus wasn't in the tomb. She had been there early that morning, and she was pretty distraught over that because she wondered what happened to his body. He's not there. John chapter 20, verse 5 says that John got to the tomb first, but he didn't go in. He stooped down, looked into the tomb, and he saw the cloths lying there on the slab where Jesus had been laid. And then Peter arrived a minute later. He wasn't as fast as John, apparently, but he went into the tomb, the Bible says. And here's what the scripture says, John 20, verse 7. He saw the linen cloths lying there and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Here's the message God was saying. From the tomb on resurrection morning, the bread of life was unwrapped and offered to the world. That's what we need to understand. The implication of that is that the bondage of your sin on that morning, on that day, the bondage of your sin was broken. In the same way that unleavened bread came out of Egypt, their bondage was broken. A picture of something bigger than that that impacts your life very, very critically. So God had pointed to what he was going to do long before, when he brought his people out of the bondage in Egypt in an incredible act, a prophetic act of deliverance. And when the bread of life from heaven was first delivered to earth, he announced it to shepherds. He gave them a sign of what the birth was all about, a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths lying in a manger. And church, Redeemer, what we're looking at this morning, I want you to know it's one facet of what's revealed in the Word of God pertaining to the fulfillment of his prophetic word foretelling the coming of Jesus. Do you realize that? I mean, there's so much more that God wants us to understand in his word about this, just to reaffirm it and get it to establish roots in your heart. Because God loves to give understanding. He loves to give you understanding when we seek it. Verse 14 says, the heart of him who has understanding seeks knowledge. There's a connection between you wanting to understand and you having understanding. But the mouths of fools feed on folly. 2 Peter 3:18 tells us that, we just heard Carol read it. God says, I want you to grow in two ways, in two areas, in the grace and in the knowledge of your Lord Jesus Christ. God says, grow in those two areas. And he wants you, what he's saying is, God's saying, I want you to be studying what my word is telling you. And if that's not part of your weekly schedule, then he's saying to you this morning, sit down and rethink this and see what you need to move in order to reprioritize and put my word into your weekly schedule, because it's that important to your life. And I have no idea what's going on in your minds right now with that, but I know God would have that to be a priority in your life. Now, in the few minutes we have this morning before communion, I want to throw some hints of things that maybe you'd want to explore. I know a lot of people say, well, I don't know where to, that's just too big a book. I can't get into that. I wouldn't even know where to start. I'm going to give you a couple of ideas or suggestions on where you can open up and see what God is pointing to all through the scriptures, things which are fulfilled in Jesus. When the Israelites did come out of Egypt, we know they spent 40 years in the wilderness because they didn't trust God. They turned away from him. Even into that context, God was pointing to Jesus in the manna over all of those 40 years that he gave the Israelites just to keep them alive for 40 years in the wilderness. And then there's a detailed description given of how Moses was to build the Ark of the Covenant. Remember that box? Not the big ark that saved Noah, the Ark of the Covenant. And he told Noah specifically what to put in it. It's in Exodus 25. I'm not going to read that. But along with a couple of other things, Moses' staff and something else, he said, I want you to put in a jar of this bread, this manna, this bread from heaven. I want you to keep that in the Ark of the Covenant. Between, and he gave him descriptions, he said, you're going to put it in the ark, you're going to place it under the mercy seat, which was the lid to this box, and on top of the mercy seat were two angels that God had him fashion and then cover in gold. So he said, I'm going to have you place this bread from heaven under the mercy seat of God between two angels. God is painting a picture here that he wants you to remember. It's a fascinating study when you read into this in Exodus and then into the fulfillment in the New Testament. Let me bring you to another time, another place where God shows us that same picture. After Peter and John had already left the tomb of Jesus that resurrection morning, the Bible says Mary kind of hung around. She was still there. She was so distraught. She was weeping bitterly outside the tomb. And she decided to look in. And this is recorded in John 20 again. And when she looked in, the Bible says she saw, listen to this, see if this is a familiar picture. She saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head, one at the feet. Same picture. Remember who the bread is. Who does that point to? Between the two angels, under the mercy seat of God in the Ark of the Covenant. All of Scripture points to, church, and is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. It's such a central, prominent message in the Bible. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, Moses prophesied to the people. Another fulfillment in Jesus. The Lord your God, Moses said, will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people, from your brothers. It is to him that you shall listen. So he said, one like Moses, like the prophet who instructed Israel to carry with them the unleavened bread wrapped in cloth out of Egypt. One like Moses, the prophet who was targeted to be killed by a tyrant king. Remember that? Who ordered all male Hebrew children to be drowned in the Nile? Remember that story? And Moses was rescued from that. One like Moses. And it amazes me. It amazes me every time I read it. I look into it. How God builds upon the prophetic words and the lives and the actions of a people or of a nation as he fulfills his purpose. When Moses' prophecy was fulfilled in the coming of Jesus, there was a very similar scene once again. Another tyrant king. What was this one's name? Herod, the baby killer, right? Ordered all male, Hebrew male children under 2 years of old surrounding Jerusalem to be killed. And the Bible even writes of the lament rising through the countryside of the mothers. Can you imagine that night? When all of these young toddlers and babies were just slaughtered because of this king who was threatened that there would be another king born. How ironic that Herod the Great had built for himself an elaborate fortress just outside of Bethlehem. You're gonna hear Pastor Ferret talk about it next week. To make sure, and he did this to make sure that he would outlive all his enemies, because he said, I'm going to build a place where I'll be untouchable from my enemies. Just a couple of miles from Bethlehem. Bethlehem was in its shadow, literally. And I remember 2 summers ago, as we stood on a trip we made, we were standing within that very fortress that Herod the Great, the baby killer, had built for himself, and which it's been more recently discovered that Herod chose to be his burial tomb. His remains are in the Herodian. He named it after himself. Of course he would. So, and they're just now uncovering his tomb in the Herodium. We were standing in the remains on top of the Herodium 2 years ago, and our leader, his name was George DeYoung. Maybe he's a relative. I'm not sure. You might get a good trip out of him. Corky. He pointed out something that was kind of interesting. He said, the very one that Herod was trying to kill Jesus, he said, is now living in you, was living in us. And I trust, I pray that that's the case in all of your lives. So he said, the one Herod was killed, was trying to kill, is now living in you. And he said, as we walked around the grounds above where Herod was buried, in that moment, he said, the one Herod, because he's in you, was trying to kill, is now literally walking on Herod's grave. It's kind of an interesting thought as we were looking at those remains of that fortress. You know, we haven't even brought up the connection to King David and the fact that Bethlehem was called the city of David. We haven't even begun to discuss the prophecy that a shoot would come forth from the stump of Jesse, who was David's father, or that Israel's Messiah would be called the son of David. We haven't touched on how the one whose birth was announced to the shepherds was both a lamb who would one day be sacrificed for them, and the very same one would be a shepherd who would lead them to springs of living water. I mean, some fascinating pictures God is giving us here. So you've got a lot of things you could explore as you make the Word of God a priority in your weekly schedule. John 6:41 says that Jesus, as he was talking to them, to the Jews, they were grumbling about what he was saying because he said this in John 6, I am the bread that came down from heaven. And they said, well, isn't this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he say, now I've come down out of heaven? And they began grumbling about that. And Jesus answered them, don't grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me. You're not going to understand this, is what he was saying, unless the Father who sent me draws them. Only God gives understanding, and he gives it to those who seek it, who make it intentional to get into the Word of God. To his own people, he was hidden. And to many outside of his own people today, he remains hidden. But to you who seek knowledge and understanding of God's ways and God's purposes, to those of you who desire to grow in the grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ, not only is understanding given, but to you is unwrapped the bread of life. And he says to you right now, come. And so we will. Amen.
Well, shepherds kept their watching, all silent flocks by night. Behold, throughout the heavens, there shone a holy light. Well, the shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed our Savior's birth.